Coming up, we're taking a look at the Indian River Lagoon system next on Central Florida on the Water. And welcome to Central Florida on the Water. This is your host, Lou McNally, and on the program tonight, we're going to discuss the Indian River Lagoon System. It stretches for almost 150 miles down the east coast of Florida. It's comprised of the Mosquito Lagoon, the Indian River, and the Banana River, and these shallow bodies of water are not really rivers at all in the traditional sense, but they make up an estuary with both fresh and salt water flowing into them. Now, the lagoons are estimated to have a $3.7 billion impact on the region. And to learn more, we're joined tonight by Jim Ross of Fineline Fishing Charters and Dr. Debra Woodall, a professor at the Institute for Marine and Environmental Studies at Daytona State College. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you for having us.
Appreciate it.
Jim, I'm going to start with you, please. Tell us a little bit about Fineline Fishing, your outfit.
Well, it's light tackle sport fishing in the lagoon systems. We've got three to choose from that you mentioned, the Indian, Banana, and Mosquito. Mm-hmm. And I also do a lot of nearshore light tackle, tarpon, cobia, snook fishing outside of Port Canaveral.
Tarpon is light tackle?
Well, comparatively.
Okay, comparatively speaking. All right. We're going to learn more about your business in just a little bit. But Dr. Woodall, let me ask you how the Institute for Marine and Environmental Science, or Studies, I guess, got started.
It began in 2010. I joined the faculty at Daytona State College in 2008 and immediately recognized the wonderful opportunities that could be available to students to study the Indian River Lagoon, which is the most diverse estuary in North America.
Really?
And it is. And of course, we also have the Atlantic Ocean right outside of our door here. Mm-hmm. So I went to our administration and I asked them if it would be possible, and they were very strongly in support of it, so that's how it became created. And so far, what we have is the Institute of Marine Environmental Studies offers four AA transfer track degrees, one in marine science, mm-hmm. marine biology, environmental science, and ocean engineering. Wow. And we also have an AS degree in environmental science technology.
So where are some of the students going beyond after they take the associates here?
We have students that have transferred to the University of Florida, University of South Florida, Stetson University, Florida Atlantic University. So we have connections with all of the major universities in the state of Florida.
Well, that sounds great. We actually have a little piece of tape here that we put together to take a closer look at IMES. Here we go.
So today, we're going to learn about something that I think is really fascinating. We're going to be learning about weather balloons.
In the IMES lab, we have state-of-the-art equipment that help us further our research.
Surveying these seagrass beds here at Oak Hills and looking at how they're changing over time.
I love doing this, coming out into the field and actually getting my hands dirty. And
you get to do everything you've ever wanted to do in a marine biology program. You get to go out into the field and actually do the work.
We are truly building a program here for students that are interested in conducting undergraduate research. It's a rather rigorous program for a two-year college.
I'm going out and studying horseshoe crab populations and seeing where their nesting sites are and how often they nest, where they are.
The professors motivate us, they inspire us to continue our research and to better ourselves in the scientific community.
This is much better than sitting in a classroom just looking at pictures and listening to people talk. We get to actually feel and see the plants in their natural habitat.
I love this class. I love everything about it, the learning of the names of the flowers. Now I could, it's like putting a name with a face.
Well, it looks like your students get an awful lot of experience there with the flora and the fauna and doing other kinds of research in the lagoons and measuring water quality, I'm sure, is one of them. And I do want to talk about that a little bit later. But first of all, tell me about the levels in the lagoons. Are they affected by just the tides or are there other things?
It actually depends on where you are within the Indian River Lagoon system. If you're within close proximity to one of the inlets, then you're probably more tidally influenced as far as the level of the water. However, there are many portions of the lagoon that are far from one of these inlets that is likely more impacted by river runoff, creek runoff, or precipitation.
Tell me a bit, if you would, about what's going on with the fact that there's salt and fresh water and the mix here. How does that affect it?
Right. It's going to impact, of course, the closer you are to one of the freshwater inlets, whether it be a creek or a river that comes in, you're going to have different types of vegetation, and you can actually see the the transition between fresh and saltwater vegetation as you come into those systems. And each one of those are going to be vary in habitat and have different types of fish species, for example. Mm-hmm. So that's what you can see the difference in.
Is there any part of the system that you're most concerned with right now?
We're most concerned about most all of it, actually. There are problems now with harmful algal blooms, are called HABs, or harmful algal blooms. And right now, brown tide and green algae are now coming back in, which can have a major impact on the habitats here in the Indian River Lagoon. For example, the brown algae, because it clouds the water, it's mm-hmm. going to block the sunlight, and it's going to hurt or kill some of our very important seagrass habitats.
Wow.
It can also, the brown algae also releases a mucus that can actually cause problems with the feeding of shellfish. It can actually slow down the feeding of shellfish.
Speaking of which, do we get red tide in the lagoons?
We do get red tide occasionally, but right now the big problem is the brown tide.
It's the brown tide. Well, let me change over to you here for a moment, Jim, and ask you what in your livelihood is the difference between the three lagoons for you?
Well, depending on the species that we want to target and the time of the year, the fish have a tendency to move between lagoon systems depending on what their needs are at that time, mm-hmm. whether it be their food needs or their water quality needs. And we're finding at this time, and unfortunately, we normally have very clean water conditions in the lagoon systems in the Indian and the Banana lagoons and the South Mosquito Lagoon. And right now, like Dr. Woodall was saying, we have a lot of problem with the brown algae. So we have the fish leaving those areas and going to areas that are cleaner, mm-hmm. and cleaner, closer to the inlets because there's getting more flush or more interaction with the ocean. So we're seeing a concentration of fish in those parts of the lagoon system.
Another reason that these fish are actually moving is because the brown algae, when it dies, it actually consumes oxygen, so you have low oxygen levels.
So
the fish are moving away.
Yeah. Nothing left for the fish.
If they don't, they'll die.
We have a graphic coming up here which shows the three lagoons here, and I wonder if you could tell me, based on what we see here, we've got the Mosquito, the Indian River, and the Banana. What the big differences are between the three?
Well, the Mosquito Lagoon, from right about the point where the arrow is northward, which would be the top of the screen,
mm-hmm.
that is the portion of the lagoon system that actually does see some tidal influence. From there south, there's really no tidal influence. It's more wind-driven type of a scenario. Pretty much all of the Indian River Lagoon system that's depicted on this graphic mm-hmm. is all wind-driven and in freshwater inflow driven as far as the water quality and the water height goes. And the Banana River is the same way as the Indian.
And you say it extends a little bit further, right?
It's 150 miles long.
Wow. So what kind of fish are your clients going for?
Well, just depending on the time of the year, we've got 15 or 20 different types of species that we can go for. Primarily in the southern lagoons, Mosquito Lagoon system, all of the Indian and all of the banana. Speckled trout, which is a member of the drum family.
That's a freshwater fish?
That's a saltwater fish.
Saltwater trout?
Saltwater trout.
Learn something.
That's
new every
one
day?
Of our primary species that we target. This one is a redfish. It's denoted by the spot on the tail. Mm-hmm. This one is as well. And those inhabit the shallow grass flats. We find a lot of those fish there. This one's a little bit bigger. We find those fish out in 3 to 4 feet of water, mm-hmm. for the most part. And then this is one of our black drum. Now, the black drum will come shallow. However, once they get to this size, they have a tendency to stay in 3 to about 8 feet of water. So that's where we target those bigger fish,
right.
is in those deeper parts of the lagoon system.
What does the drum mean? I mean, I know a snook looks like a snook, and a dolphin fin, mm-hmm. well, looks like a dolphin fish. But what's a drum?
Well, it's a family of fish, and they're denoted by the ability to make a noise, not like a croaking noise, like a croaker, a member of the croaker family would be, but they make what they call a drumming noise,
mm-hmm.
and they take a nerve, and they rub the nerve down the side of their air bladder to create a drumming sound. The black drum have the most prominent drumming sound, the speckled trout. Even though most people don't recognize them as a drum species, they do have that ability as well.
Are they
you just
using
don't
that
hear
to
it very much.
Contact each other? Or?
They can do it while they're feeding. You'll hear drumming noises while in their courting and spawning rituals, you'll hear it. And then just typical communication, and especially in the black drum and the red drum, there's a lot of vocalization between them, or we call it vocalization, mm-hmm. it's that drumming effect. And they can be an alarm drum, it can be an excited drum, it can be a locating type of a drum. It can be a call to group back together kind of a drumming. And if you're out there on really calm days, you can actually hear them sometimes and then watch the fish. If it's real calm, you can watch them group up or disperse depending on what they're trying to do at that particular time.
Well, this is why people want you when they go out chartering. I imagine you have to use some slightly different boats for these different shallows and depths.
Yeah, most of the time we use what is called a flat skiff,
mm-hmm.
and I have one of those. It's a 17-foot model.
Flats boat.
Flats boat, yeah. And small skiffs, anything from a John boat to about a 20-foot mm-hmm. flats-type boat, full decking, very shallow draft, and allows you to maneuver the boat with either a push pole or a trolling motor.
Right.
And then I have a larger boat called a bay boat or a bay skiff,
mm-hmm.
and those can go up into the 23, 24-inch range. And I have a 24-footer, so I have on the bottom end I've got a 17-foot flat skiff, on the top end of boats to fish actively and correctly fish the lagoon system, I've got the 24-foot bay boat. And they all float in less than about 14 inches of water.
Really? Wow. Well, we actually have a little piece here coming up where Captain Jim is going to show us his boat and explain some of the ideal features to have in case you're looking for a boat for fishing the lagoons.
Hey there, I'm Captain Jim Ross, and I want to show you some of the things that you want to look for if you're looking for a boat that's going to work for you in the lagoon system in nearshore waters, pretty much anywhere that there's some coastal saltwater or freshwater habitat throughout the United States. I prefer a bay-style boat or a bay-style skiff, and this happens to be a center console design where you can see the console is positioned specifically in the center of the boat with walkways on either side. It has some rod storage features on the side of it so that I can carry my fishing tackle there. It also has some other features that are really nice. A large LCD screen so I can find the fish or my way up and down the lagoon systems, and also some creature comforts like tilt steering, where I can maneuver the steering wheel however I like to fit myself and my clients as they need to get in and out of here. Positioning on this console itself also is better if you have a boat that is positioned to one side or the other rather than having a steering wheel in the middle, because it allows you to stand here while your companion stands next to you, and both of you can utilize the seating scenario or the leaning post in this case. And speaking of the leaning post, when you're looking at the leaning post, you want to make sure that the company that you buy your boat from gives you enough room between the leaning post and the console. Some of them get too close, and it makes it very difficult to access this area or to the inside of the console to get anything that you may need to get out of there. The leaning post itself has a lot of different features. It's got some rod rack features, and it's also got a storage feature on the inside of it where you can keep various things. I happen to keep extra sunglasses, sunblock, extra line, my power pole remote for my shallow water anchoring device, which I'm going to put on right now, and also my remote control for my trolling motor that we're going to talk about in just a little bit. Another nice thing about a bay style skiff is that you have optional seating, when you have a smaller technical poling skiff or flats type boat, you don't have as much versatility, so it's harder to take the family or a group of friends out. With the jump seats that we have on the bay boats, you have these optional jump seats that simply fold up or fold down as needed. You can simply fold them back down, and now you have an excellent large rear deck that you can cast and fish from. The bay boats also have an additional amount of storage compared to some of the smaller flat skiffs. And in addition to that stable, big platform, you've got really, really deep access hatches that you can put buckets down in. They normally have hydraulic hinges to keep them open so they don't slam down and spook the fish as well. And they have nice locking latches to keep them in place so that they don't rattle when you're riding up and down the lagoon system. A nice live well, specifically designed for larger baits or large or your slot size or larger fish. Now the other thing that we have is a front live well, and that's where we normally put our shrimp and smaller baits. And that one is located underneath the front seat here. So we've got the cushion, and then we've also got a clear lid to keep the water from splashing out of the live well. And in this case, I'm keeping shrimp in here, my port side of the boat, my left-hand side. I have got a rod locker. Once again, it's lockable, and I can keep my fishing rods stowed down below deck until I want to fish with them, and then I can bring them out and put them in the upright rod holders. So a lot of the boats you'll see will either have a push pole or a power operated motor like this one. And this is called a trolling motor, and we don't necessarily troll with it, but it is a battery operated electric motor that allows you to move around in the flats, especially in the Mosquito Lagoon and the Indian River, very, very quietly in comparison to your main outboard motor. This one happens to have a little locking collar on it that you slide up and down to adjust the depth that you want it to go to. You lock it back in place, you push down and in, and it slides overboard just like so, locks in place, and engages. Now you'll notice that this one does not have a handle on it. This is a remote control bow mount unit, and I have a little remote control unit in my hand here, and I can just simply turn the motor whichever direction I want it to go. I can adjust the speed that I want it to go at, and I can actually hold in one position if I want to do that as well. So you can stay very, very quiet without running your main motor by utilizing one of these little electric jobs. Now another thing you want to look for in the modern style skiff or bay boat is four-stroke power. Four-stroke power is much cleaner, much quieter, much more fuel efficient than the older two-stroke technology. And some of the horsepower ratings get up into the 250 and 300 horsepower for some of the larger bay boats. So you can cruise effectively at half or three-quarter throttle and still make very good time up and down the lagoon systems without overburdening the gas consumption and your wallet in the meantime.
That looks like fun indeed, but how about if you don't have a boat? You can still fish in the lagoons, can't you?
Oh, most definitely. There's fishing piers all through the Volusia County area in the Mosquito Lagoon side. There are also quite a few in the Indian River side, all the way down to the Sebastian Inlet area. There's a few in the Banana River, but not as many. There's more causeways and things like that that you can park along and fish there. But one of the best places to actually wade fish or walk in and fish is the Merritt Island National Wildlife Refuge, mm-hmm. and you can access the southern part of it, which accesses the Indian River, or the western part of it that accesses the Mosquito Lagoon by foot or by car.
How seasonal is the fishing in the lagoons?
We fish year-round. The fish move from one place to another just depending on the temperatures. It's all about comfort, just like us. We don't want to be too hot, we don't want to be too cold, and we want to be somewhere relatively close to food. So temperature and food is really the driving factors that make the fish move around. Sometimes we'll find them in just inches, 6-7 inches of water. Sometimes they're in 6-7 feet of water. Just depends on what that comfort level that they require for that time of the year is.
We're going to expand a little bit on that this week. As a matter of fact, Captain Jim is going to be our tip of the week. He shared with us some of the most popular techniques for fishing in the lagoons.
So now that I've got my sounding unit turned off, my motor's turned off, I've trimmed up so that I'm not dragging the bottom when we get into these real shallows, the next thing we want to do is go get on our quiet motor, that electric motor that we talked about in the earlier part of the show. So I'm going to deploy this, and then we're going to sneak up into this area of real shallow water. There's only 18 inches, maybe 24 inches of water up here, but the fish should be holding up in here looking for a bait fish and shrimp to feed on. So I'm going to go put that over and then just quietly ease up that last 150 to 200 yards on that quiet motor. So now that we're in here, we go ahead and we get our fishing rod out, and a lot of things determine what you're going to use whenever you're talking about the types of lures or baits. Early in the morning, or whenever you've got overcast conditions, a noisy rattling plug like this has a tendency to work very, very well. It's got a bunch of rattles in it. The fish can locate it from a long way away because they can hear it. Remember we talked about the importance of sound, about being quiet getting into the area. Once we're there, we want to allow the fish to find our lure by using the sound. So that little rattling noise allows them to come and find it. This type of a lure floats right on top of the water, and we use what's called a walk the dog method to bring. So it's important to make long casts when you're fishing in the shallow water, in the saltwater flats as we call it. And that large topwater plug that we just talked about a second ago can normally cast anywhere from 60 to 100 feet, depending on the type of rod and line and gear that you're using. So you want to make a nice long cast and get away from the boat. Once again, just to keep the fish from knowing that you're there and concentrating solely on the bait or the lure that you're trying to present to them. Normally when I'm fishing this type of a lure, I like to let it sit on the water for just a couple of seconds, and then I give it just a couple of twitches. It almost acts like a fish that was stunned. It lays there for a second, and then all of a sudden it starts to wake up and it goes, hey, and it starts to wiggle. Then pause it again and a couple of more twitches. Okay, now it's regaining its composure. It's not as stunned, and then I start to work it back into the boat with a cadence, a twitch, 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 and then pause. Twitch, 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 twitch. Maybe give it a couple of extra twitches, a twitch, 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 like that, so that it still looks like it's injured or maybe trying to escape something, but it's definitely something that's going to be making noise. The rattles are going to be rattling in there. You're going to be displacing water on the top with the lure, and it's something that the fish can key in on and follow back to that sound until they actually can see the lure and attack the lure. So we just talked about topwater plugs. There's a couple of other kinds of lures that we use out here in the flats. Sometimes, if there's not a lot of ripple on the water and it's extremely glassy and smooth, a better type of a lure to use is a soft plastic jerkbait. Now, this is a little soft plastic jerkbait that just comes on a worm hook, and it's basically came from the freshwater market. The bass guys were the ones that developed this, and then it's just transitioned over to the trout and redfish and snook guys over here in the saltwater side. What we do is we rig it with a hook that can be rigged in a weedless fashion through the bait, and then actually skin hook it, so that what you have now is you have a lure that will slide through the grass and not pick the grass up until the fish actually bites the lure and exposes the point, which it, when you feel the bite, you set the hook and then you pull the hook right into the side of the fish's mouth. Now to fish this type of a soft plastic bait, then I make a nice long cast to where I think that fish is going to be. I close my bail, and I let this sink down just a little bit, and then I start to twitch it and work it back in. And I sometimes start with a slow retrieve, a hopping kind of retrieve, and let that lure bob up and down in the water column. And then other times, I use a much faster retrieve, like it's a fleeing bait fish, where I'll twitch it a little bit quicker, more like I was working the topwater plug, and putting a lot more action and imparting a lot more speed into that lure to bring it back, like it's a little fleeing needlefish or fleeing ballyhoo or possibly a little mullet or pilchard that's working its way through the water trying to run from whatever was behind it. Most of the time, the way that our lagoon waters are stained or just off colored, a rattling cork works better than either of these two. It's high vis, so you can see it very easily even when it's a long way away from you, and it has beads and rattles on it. And you can hear, makes a lot of noise. If they're not quite so receptive to that, then going with one that may not be as loud. This one is not quite as loud because the cork isn't as heavy. And also one that has a live bait option under it. You'll see I've got a split shot and a weight, or a split shot for a weight, and a hook underneath it. And to this, you'll want to rig a shrimp. So we take our live shrimp, and I prefer to rig them through the last segment of the tail. That last segment is stronger than any other part, including the carapace on the shrimp. So I go in the bottom and out the top of that very last segment of the tail. So to fish the popping cork and shrimp or popping cork and jig combo, You want the lure or the shrimp to be just above the seagrass or the bottom. So we're in about, 25 inches of water here. So I've got about 20 inches between the shrimp and the actual, where the float is gonna sit against the stopper at the top. So that'll hold it just off the bottom and allow the shrimp to kick around and swim. You have to throw the live baits a little bit softer than you do the artificials. It's more of a lob cast than it is a really fast pitching type of a cast. So you just kind of lob it out there, let it sit. Then I give it a couple of minutes, just like I did with the topwater plug, or a couple of seconds, just like I did with the topwater plug. And then I give it a little twitch, maybe a double twitch, and then I just let it sit again. As soon as it goes under the water, I know a fish has grabbed it, and then I want to start reeling until I come tight with the fish, and then I can set the hook.
All right, we also want to mention, of course, that Jim was wearing that to keep the sun off of his skin, so we don't want to scare any of the kids at home, right?
No.
Thanks for those tips, appreciate it. Dr. Woodall, can you tell us briefly what kind of research the students are doing over in your program?
They are excited, working hard. I've got some of the best students probably in the state of Florida. I've had one student, for example, who was nationally recognized for her research on ocean plastics. Ocean plastics is a growing problem. You may have heard about the garbage patch, like in the middle of the Pacific Ocean.
The Sargasso Sea.
We have one in the Atlantic Ocean as well. In addition to that, I have a student that is currently actually looking at microplastics in the Indian River Lagoon. We have a problem with microplastics. Some of them come from, cosmetic. We have some that, believe it or not, if you wear those wonderful fleece jackets, will produce a lot of microplastics that end up in the Indian River Lagoon and get into your wonderful fish species. So we're now eating microplastics in our food.
I noticed one thing with some of your students in that piece that we saw before. There are some older folks there.
Well, some of those students are actually enrolled in the Environmental Science Technology program, and that program is specifically designed to get you in and out to get a job. So some of them are coming back for a second career.
Sounds great. Well, we'll learn more about that and how people can learn more, but I'm afraid we've run out of time. We're at the end of the program. I want to thank Captain Jim Ross and Dr. Debra Woodall for joining us. Jim, what's the best way for people to get in touch with you?
They can contact me on my website, FineLineFishingCharters.com, and that's a very easy one to remember, and you can book a trip right there.
Perfect. Right there. Sounds good. And Dr. Woodall, how are we getting the information on the IMES?
Certainly. DaytonaState.edu/IMES.
Institute for Marine and Environmental Studies.
Correct.
Sounds great. If you have a question out there or a comment, please email us at wdsc@daytonastate.edu or go to our Facebook page. And to check out our schedule, visit our webpage at wdsctv.org. You can also find other episodes of this series and other local programs online in the WDSC YouTube channel. We'll see you next time. Boat safe.